You know, it's nice out here today, getting ready to bless the building. We know that the city and the police officers protect and serve us. And the question always remains, who protects and serves those who protect and serve us? So today's a good day as we come and celebrate and look at how we can continue to have community unity and just make the dream a reality. Hey.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Captain Jill Gladio, your MC for this evening and a very memorable event. We are so glad you could join us as we showcase the two floors of the Greensboro Police Department brand new building that has been renovated. This will be the third floor and the fifth floor. The renovations are more than just a facelift. The new offices provide greater efficiency among our staff, a vast improvement for conducting public business, and are more representative of GPD's professional image. If you've already taken the tour, then you know. If you haven't by chance, we will offer more after the ceremony. Today is also exciting because we will be burying two time capsules. One capsule contains memorabilia donated by the public, and the other is filled with items contributed by the Greensboro Police Department. These capsules are meant to be opened approximately 100 years from now during National Police Week. We hope the officers and the community members of the future enjoy the capsules as much as we do. Now I'll turn it over to Chief Scott to offer some opening remarks.
Thank you, Captain. It's kind of humbling, isn't it? I really would like to just take a look around. What an incredible and wonderful day to be a member of the Greensboro Police Department, quite honestly, to be a member of the community we call Greensboro. None of this would have been possible for our police department, for our government, without everyone here, all the hands on deck, if you will say. So I would like to start this great event by catching my own paper. And by saying, let's all have a round of applause for all that made this possible. Thank you. I do want to take just a moment, so bear with me as I try to recognize some folks. Some of these individuals have sent their well wishes. Some are actually here present. But obviously, we have a number of dignitaries here, and I'm going to try to run down the list very quickly. I know Congressman Mark Walker was going to be here. I know his representative from his office is here. Thank you. Mayor Vaughn, Councilman Allen, Councilman Abdelwader, Councilman Hoffman, Councilman Dr. Wells, Mayor Pro Tem, and our city manager all sitting here on the front row. And I'd like to give a second round of applause just for them. Thank you for being here. For your attention. We also have representatives from our assistant city manager, both Barbara Harris and David Parrish are here. And I'd like to give a special thanks to a retired assistant city manager, Mr. Mike Spieling, who was actually instrumental in us acquiring this building several years ago. So let's give him a round of applause. A lot of things are going to be happening in the next just few minutes. As you know, we have a foundation event going on, so several members of the Greensboro Police Foundation are here. Our foundation president, Oliver Lloyd, as well as some special guests related specifically to the first part of this ceremony, which is all around burying of time capsules right behind me. Mr. Steve Blackwell from the Lambert Proctor Funeral Home is here, as well as Bill Norton from the Wilbur Funeral Services, who made these time capsules possible. And I'd love for everybody, before you leave, to walk up here and take a look at these incredible time capsules. They're not what I at all envisioned and what a time capsule would look like. They're actually very, very beautiful, and I hope 100 years from now someone gets the pleasure of opening it up and seeing them. I'd also like to take an opportunity to thank our first responders and representatives here today. I know that our fire chief, Bobby Nugent, and our 911 director, Melanie Neal, are both here, so I'd like to give another round of applause to all of my partners. Thank you. We also have representatives of the Gulf County Sheriff's Department, High Point Police Department. Our U.S. Marshal is present today. Our chief of the Burlington Police Department has already departed, and several other agencies are represented. I see one of the folks from A&T State University back there, so a lot of partner law enforcement agencies are here today. Thank you for all coming. Additionally, I'd like to thank Reverend Odell Cleveland, which I flipped around just a moment ago, who's a member of our Faith Advisory Council. He's doing an amazing job, and he's going to actually be joining us on the steps for the ribbon cutting in just a moment. The last round of applause I'll ask you to give is one just in its entirety for the Greensboro Police Department. It took an incredible amount of just work equity to create this event today and for the last few years to create everything that's happened. So one last round of applause for the GPD. Thank you. At this time, I'm going to ask our city manager to come up. He's going to give a few words. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Goldie. My name is Jim Westmoreland. I'm the city manager here for Greensboro. And it's my privilege to welcome you today to the ribbon cutting ceremony to officially open up the full scope of the building of the police department. Also, as the chief mentioned, I too wanted to thank the members of the Greensboro Police Foundation for all of your leadership, all of your support. I was telling somebody a while ago, I had a chance, an opportunity to experience what back in 1989 was an experience in the city where we had to use the Mobile Command Center. And I'm just so grateful and thankful that the Police Foundation and membership was able to step up and help us find this new piece of equipment for our department. I think it's reflective of both the equipment and what you'll see inside today, what we're focused on in Greensboro as it relates to public safety, as it relates to quality of service. I know that the chief and his team, like you mentioned, have done an excellent job of planning and coordinating all the logistics of being able to make this move happen for us here today. But more importantly, I too, and this is coming directly from me and how I feel about our department, wanted just to thank our men and women of the police department today for all they do for our community. Let's give them a round of applause. These representatives do everyday things that I can't imagine. I've had an opportunity to go on a police ride around with them on many occasions. And I can tell you that their work today is extraordinarily hard, it's extraordinarily complex and taxing, but they do it better than anybody else in the nation as far as I'm concerned. And certainly I know that our council continues to place a very strong priority on what we're doing in funding and supporting all of our public safety providers in the community and the work that they do. So again, thank you for letting me be a part of the celebration today. Thanks again for those who provided the leadership and support to help us acquire the building. First of all, thank you, Michael Spiegel, to be able to be in a position to move in today and really make this a quality location for our police department going forward. So thank you, Chief.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So now to kind of the business at hand. What are we here for today? We're here to mark the grand opening of this great facility that connects our police department and our community. We're here to talk about some of the generosity of our community that has helped us be better at our jobs and helps us keep this community safe. Lastly, we're here to talk about this moment in time. And so that's my lead in to talk about time capsules. What we're gonna do today, we're gonna be burying two time capsules, one of which was populated by the community, items that were brought in from our community. And it was a vast variety of different items that I think will intrigue folks 100 years from now. Secondly, the second time capsule, and you see the photographs on both sides, are actually things that are about policing. I've been policing just about close to 27 years here in the city of Greensboro, and in my 27 years, I've seen vast changes. I can only begin to imagine what a police department 100 years from now will undertake. But I'm sure of one thing, and I actually put this in a letter to the chief from 100 years from now, that it's going to be even more important then than it is now, that it's a team effort. And that's what we believe here in Greensboro. To that end, I'd like to ask our mayor to come forward for just a moment and give her opening remarks, because part of the GPD team is interacting with our government and our community. And I want to thank you for being here and give some remarks.
Good afternoon. I want to go on record. I really do like my fellow council people, but I like the shade better. So, I remember former Chief Miller coming in and telling this story that the day before he interviewed for this job, he and his wife drove around the city of Greensboro, and they saw the MMOB across the street, and it had Greensboro Police Department on it. And he thought, wow. If that is the police department, they must really appreciate their police. And then he got in and realized that the police department was a small part of that building. So, but now when people come by and see this beautiful building, and it really has been transformed, and it looks great at night, people are going to be able to see how much we appreciate our police department. This building is a big deal. It's in a perfect location to serve the people of our city. And now it has many rooms with incredibly skilled people to bring all of our police services under one roof. It is also a welcoming space to transact business and to get to know our officers better. It is also a space for GPD employees and community members to get to know each other better and help solve problems. The design of this space reflects the neighborhood-oriented policing philosophy of our police department. It's inviting. It has meeting rooms specifically for our residents to work alongside members of the GPD to address concerns, find ways to make our city safer, and it has places to meet with officers one-on-one. These areas are intentionally furnished and decorated to make people feel at ease. A lot of thought went into every aspect of this building, and it's clear to me that the primary consideration throughout this lengthy, and it was lengthy, renovation was the needs of the people we serve. And I hope that will say a lot about our police department. And I also would like to thank the Police Foundation for the wonderful work that they do and how they have served the people of the city of Greensboro. Thank you.
This time I'm going to ask a couple of gentlemen to come up. Stephen, Bill, you'll come on up. So, how cool is it we're going to do a time tackle, right? I wish I could take credit for it. I will tell you that Steve Blackwell, who's here to my right, is actually the man who came up with the idea. So, I think it's an incredible idea, and I want to give you an opportunity.
Thank you so much, Chief. On behalf of Lambda Structure Funeral Service and Wilbur Ball of Greensboro, it's a great honor and privilege to be before this room today. This project actually began in a total different mindset of something we could do in a way of, if you will, allowing the community and us to show our great appreciation to the Greensboro Police Department for their many years of valuable service to our community. I had been involved in the past with the project that has erected the memorial in front of the headquarters station of Greensboro Fire. So naturally, this was another thought process. We wanted to give people credit and value to the Greensboro Police Department. When we first began to think about it, we were looking at something of maybe of this nature, some type of statue or monument or something that really reflected the vision and the idea of the Greensboro Police Department, such as it's shown here, the relationship between the police officer and the child. Since this already existed, it used to be over at the courthouse, then the idea was to place it here in front of the new headquarters. Well, what could that piece be? And after over a year, if you will, of the development of this idea, this is what came forward. Something that could create a permanent vessel, a way of commemorating the service of the Greensboro Police Department, replacing past artifacts of the past, as well with asking the community to be involved and submit items as well. So hence, that's what's brought it forward today. This is a great way of creating a preservation for this and continue to show the appreciation throughout the years and generations to come with Greensboro Police. Thank you.
So now the moment we're waiting for, I'll ask the mayor if he'll come back up and join us. We're gonna symbolically bury these capsules. Mr. Manford will join us. So what we're gonna do here in just a moment is move over to our right and we'll turn the first shovel of dirt to put this capsule on top. We're going to be bringing in some heavy machinery to finish this in just a few minutes.
It's a very deep hole.
Huh?
what it is.
Thank you all very much. The next part of our evening is going to be actually focused on over there in the shade, so it's a good thing. So what I'd ask you to do is start to support our main steps, and I'm going to ask the members of council if you'll please take your station on the steps just for a minute, and we'll be cutting the ribbon directly in front of you and begin to enter the building. Part of our faith advisory council would actually bless our building before we enter into it.
Okay.
This official ceremony. So, Pastor, thank you for being here.
This time would invite you to join me in blessing the building. Ask you to join me in whatever tradition, custom, or culture that you're comfortable with as I bless the building in the tradition, custom, and culture that I'm comfortable with. You know, it's interesting, many of us here today are leaders. We make so many decisions in this city that affect so many people. We continue to ask God to help us in our decision making. Let us pray. Father God, we just say thank you for this opportunity. It's just so much going on in our country, in our state, in our city. But we have a time to celebrate, God. God, many of us are leaders in this group. We're celebrating those today who we call upon to protect and serve us, God. But God, as leaders, the question remains, who's protecting those who we ask to protect us? Who's serving those who we ask to serve us? God, it comes down to leadership. We as leaders have to stand behind and support those who go out and put their lives on the line every day, God. We have to protect and serve those who protect and serve us. God, we ask for strength as we also protect and serve the community, God. God, being a leader is easy when things are easy. The cup of leadership is sweet when it's easy, like cold, sweet iced tea. But God, how about it when the cup of leadership has so much tension when the steam of opposition comes from that cup. As leaders, we still must drink from that cup, God. We must drink from the cup when the cup is a cup of agony also. Because we're asking people to put their lives on the line for this community. We have to be bold enough to drink from the cup, God. God, we have an example found in the Garden of Gethsemane. Many of us, when there's opposition, would want to say the same prayer. If this cup can pass from me. But let us be reminded that at the cost of leadership, we must say, but not our will, but thy will be done. It costs to be a leader. God, we thank you for this building that's going to bless this community. And we bless this community, and we bless those who we ask to protect and serve us. We thank you, we praise you. Amen.
Incredibly strong words. Thank you, Pastor. So now we are going to have the right and the privilege to rededicate. Councilman Allen, going to make it. There we go.
I'll ask the mayor and the city manager to join us.
Thanks.
These are sharp. So what we will do, if we're fully called, is on the count of three, we will officially reopen the 100 Police Plaza. One, two, three.
Yay! Yay.
What we used to have and what we have now, this bag right here is what every officer used to give you. It's kind of, it's like just a duffel bag. But now, every officer gets issued one of these. It's a patrol bag. There is a strap that you can put over the passenger seat and open it up, and you can keep all your files and everything organized. And what's in here now is the equipment that every recruit gets issued in the class. You have a clipboard, a holster, pretty much everything that's lined up over there. They get issued in this bag. And along with that, they get a helmet like this and a gas mask for like situations where they need to like use seeing gas or something like that to get somebody out. That way it doesn't bother them. This is also a traffic mess that they get issued. And I'll bring you over here. So this is the flashlight that we used to issue. If you can see, it's not that bright. This is the ones we issue now. Much bright. And there's a whole bunch of different modes you can make it dimmer. You can make it flashlight. But then, this is the body on that we used to issue. Pick it up and just go out and that is.
Oh.
Yeah.
You have any pounds?
I don't know how many pounds.
10
pounds. It's just heavy. So you're wearing that, okay? This is what you're wearing now.
Well,
yeah. And the best part is that vest has more stopping power than this vest does. So that gives you more protection. And it's lighter, it breathes better. And this right here is the jacket that we used to issue. It's just, you know, ordinary jacket. But the ones that we issue now, they have an outer liner for like rain and everything. And then they have this inner liner that's microfleece, so it keeps really warm and it doesn't make as much noise as these do. So you got better protection, better equipment and everything. And then you have it so they can pick this up. And remember, it doesn't have a real gun or bullets in it. And every officer wears that for 11 hours a day.
Oh,
yeah.
Heavy.
Yeah. Oh, it's really heavy.
It's so heavy.
Yeah. And then, these are the radios that we're switching. We carried these. Well, some officers carry these now. We're switching over to these radios. And these have Bluetooth capability and GPS, and then range is a whole lot better. So like if there's an emergency situation and they have to hit their emergency button on the radio, we know exactly where, yeah, we know exactly where they are when we come in. And now we're done. This is our body-worn camera. Yeah.
and it's magnetic. This goes on the inside of their shirt, and it just connects right there. They turn it on, and then whenever they're going to a call, they just hold down this button, and it starts recording. And it does audio and video, has a wide range of view, good sound, and so it just gives it the
I feel call. That is one of the best things.
Oh, yeah.
In the latter days, you got it.
Yeah, because, you know, it's not he said, she said, you have.
Yes, and if somebody calling again, it's the recording with them.
Mm-hmm. So, but yeah, in that room over there, that's where we keep all our spare weapons and stuff. And like if an officer comes in and they have an issue with their pistol, I'll go in there and get them a spare, issue that to them, and then I'll take the broken one and I'll take it into this room and I'll repair it and fix it. And these shelves that are right here, we used to have those shelves covering up the whole basement room down here. But we recently went to an online ordering system, and so what that did was it cut down our inventory a whole lot, so we don't have a whole bunch of unused equipment. Like I was telling the last group that came in, we had a sergeant here that he was the only person that wore back size pants. And he retired 6 years ago. And whenever we were switching over to the system, we were trying to get rid of all of the extra equipment stuff. There were 20 pairs of pants still inside, and he was the only person that wore them. So now that the new system is helping save money, and it's cutting down on this extra inventory that we have. But that's pretty much what we do. We do that, issue all of this stuff to everybody, handle, you know, any problems that may come about.
The foundation helped donate for us, and the United Healthcare is doing sign calling. It's great. It's got nice views. When you're on the treadmill, you can see out. There's always something to see outside. So it's got fantastic views for a gym.
They have to come to the gym, or it's optional?
It's optional. It's optional. It's optional.
Okay.
And right now, no one's going to fall dead in here because there's so many people coming through. It gets a lot of work early in the morning and late at night because that's when a lot of people are available. They come really early before the shift or come super late at night when no one's around. The men's locker room is on the door to the left right there, and the women's is back out on this.
My name is Krista Boswell. I'm with Public Safety IT. We have about 800 officers that we support between, we do all their mobile computers, all of their desk computers, office computers, all of their cell phones. We have about 900 cell phones between cell phones and data devices. We have about 25 servers that we support between here and Gopher Metro. We are a redundant site, so we have spots out at Gopher Metro, and if they fail or we have a problem, it goes to our backup sites. We use everything from Panther Toughbooks, which are used all in our patrol cars. They can map things such as calls. They'll see things on the map where the other calls are. Weather units, all cars coming in. All of our detectives, most of those are using Surfaces. These are Microsoft Surfaces. They are able to take them out in the field. They're able to go in homes with them, whatever they need to do, witness statements. They can take them in. It's pretty good. All of our admin staff either uses Dell laptops or we use desktop PCs, depending on what their job assignment is. We have iPads we use for things like the video room in here. You're getting ready to see if you haven't been there already. I don't know if you have or not. We can control all of those screens on the wall with the iPad. So, and then we also are using Android. So right now we're using Samsung Galaxy S7s. That's what we're getting right now for all of our phone users. We have things such as it's called Freedom, and they can actually get dispatched and see all the calls on the cell phone. So if an officer isn't assigned an MCT, then they can use it on the phone. Anybody have any questions?
What I do in the Office of Community Engagement is I'm working on a couple programs. One in which I'm working on is the Explorer program. It's a teen program for kids 14 to 20. And we're looking to help build leaders, is what we're looking to do, help them in any career that they want to do. We're looking for kids to just mentor, help them with schoolwork, help them to get scholarships, help them to find the college they want to go to, maybe a job while they go to college, and to build relationships. And so that's what this is about. And this is starting October the 10th. You can more than happy to take one of these. And if you know anybody, we'd love to have some applicants come in.
Maybe my son.
That'd be great. We'd love that. And
I'm Officer Jefferson. I work out of District 3, the Patrol Division. On my downtime or
outside of, you know, normal patrol duties, I help with recruiting for the department. Myself and Officer LeBaire just spent our Tuesday at App State talking to a lot of people. Hopefully we'll get a lot of applicants to come apply with our department. That's what I do. And I also will be helping out with the Explore program when it kicks off here in a couple weeks.
We are responsible for the 5 different major programs that are housed out of this shop, and that's going to be the National Night Out, Operation Pass, Operation Yuletide, Police Memorial Week, and Special Olympics. So it's 3 of us that work in this office. This is Ms. Council, and I'm definitely taking it from there. But thank you so much.
Gentlemen, doing all right today? Fantastic. Delicia Council, Community Relations Specialist for the department. As my colleague did mention, some of the things that we do, it's very essential that our officers get the benefit of having what we consider to be a liaison between themselves and the community. And so that's really the role that we serve for the department. My colleague just mentioned many of the events that come out of this office that we're responsible for, but our primary goal is really behind the scenes. And what we want to do is we want to make sure that our sworn officers are as effective as they need to be, and we get to assist them with reaching out to the community and just kind of helping them with that soft entry of communication and the events and things like that that they choose to do or want to do or have a heart to do in the community. And so to do that, we get to come aboard and partner with them and go out and really help with the planning and the logistics and organizing those such events. So we're really excited because we really get to do a huge piece of that engaging part for them and with them. But also in this space, what you'll see here, one of the first spaces that you do get to see here is what we consider to be our soft room. And that's because what we want is we want this space to be very inviting and very engaging. So when you come here, you just have more of a relaxed feel. So we're super excited about the role our chief has us playing in the department. And we feel it to be a great joy that we get to partner with our sworn officers and help them in the art of communication and the art of engagement and community outreach. So we're just super delighted with the role that we have.
You guys, welcome to the bag, also.
There are currently 3 of us in this unit, but there are 4 analysts, and we are each assigned to one of the 4 districts and a supervisor position. We handle the statistics for the department. We come in every day, and one of the first things that we do and try to do every day is look for crime trends and patterns as they emerge in the area and put together what we call crime pattern trackers or bulletins and get them sent out. Here are some examples of what those look like. And get those sent out to the officers on the street so that they can be in the area where the crimes are occurring, especially during times that they're not call answering, to kind of try to be proactive. If you're not familiar with crimemapping.com, you can actually sign up for it. And here's some directions if you want to take one of those with you. You can enter your address, and it'll notify you when a crime occurs within whatever radius that you've chosen to be notified by text or email. Or both, I think you can choose. And it's great for people who, we get a lot of calls with the crime, like in this area, my daughter's going to school there, or we've never even been to Greensboro and we're moving there. So all of our crime data is published out there, and we just send folks to look at it. What else can we guys?
And we're also here for any requests that the public has or media for in terms of crime statistics for the city. And
cool. And then we provide support for all our other special units as well, such as school resource, special operations, traffic division. We look at their data too and try to help them determine where we're having the most crashes or where we're having a lot of speeding or, you know, those things.
To police the police, so to say. What we've added here is, of course, we have a waiting room. If any complainants come up, they sit here. Not everyone has access to our office because we have personnel record confidential files. So the only people that work in here and the chief's wing have access to get into this area. So officers do report here if they have an interview. What we've added that's nicer than what we had at the old building is we have a waiting room. There's a stigma with going to professional standards, as you can imagine, because you're here usually because there's an allegation against you of possible misconduct or breaking a rule or something. So we have a waiting room inside now that the officers can come sit and wait if they happen to have a hearing or anything like that, or wait for an interview. The staff that works in professional standards, captain, I have a lieutenant that works in here, and the sergeants work in here. We have someone with somewhat of a rank, first line supervisors. That way when they're calling in officers, you know, there's a supervisor feel that when they're doing the investigations. So we have a conference room in back, and of course a file room, various investigators. Again, a file room for our current staff. And a conference room, it can be used for meetings. Officers do have the right to due process. So if there is an allegation on an officer, this is where we would have a hearing. We bring them in, and if they're on an allegation that's likely to be sustained, that is found guilty, then they're afforded a hearing if they wish. Usually the hearings are seated with a deputy chief, and then I would be here as the commander of internal affairs. The investigator that did the case will have an HR representative from the city, and then the chain of command. The chain of command is actually the one that adjudicates any of the allegations. A lot of people think that we do the adjudication, we merely do the investigation, and then the chain of command does the adjudication. You know,
but it is for the police or for the city.
This is for the police officers, yes, in the city. Yes, or any city employee, even our non-sworn, are held to our rules and regulations. So our crime scene investigator, record personnel, administrative, sweet little Miss Rose up there could have to come in for something if there was an allegation of a complaint. So, any questions?
Well, we run the budget through here. We run about $74 million in budget. That's including the payroll, plus we have grants that we get from the state and federal governments. We run the contracts and the bills we have to pay and the money that we get in, we handle it through here.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
This is resource management. We handle any kind of personnel issues with the police department, everything from workman's comp, HR issues. We do hiring, background investigations. We don't issue discipline, but we kind of help manage when discipline's issued to officers. Time, any kind of vacation, leave issues, you kind of name it, we're a jack of all trades in here. Down here is my office and the captain's office. Kim Bauer's office there, she manages off-duty work. An officer could be hired by a store to kind of provide security for the store in an off-duty capacity. She manages that and makes sure what the business wants the officer to do is in compliance with what we allow them to do. Rachel and Shirley are HR representatives. They handle the workman's comp, leave issues, any kind of personnel HR problem, they'll help resolve it. And then if you want to come down here, have you taken them down here yet?
Oh, we walked past it. I said that's my area.
Yeah, it's just a few offices. This is where background investigations get done. Previously, our internal affairs section did backgrounds for people that want to get hired. You know, if someone applies with us, we can't just hire them off the street. We have to make sure that they have lived their life up to the standards we need. And they'll just look into their history and make sure there's nothing that would preclude them from being a police officer. And that's, we moved them in here because we managed hiring itself, so it kind of made sense that the backgrounds would be under our shop.
So this is our office. We are the attorneys assigned to the police department, so we do all kinds of stuff. General litigation, give legal advice, we write a legal update, teach in the academy, teach in service, all kinds of stuff.
I tell you, we have several conference rooms, like I said. It seems to be, there's meetings all the time, and so everyone needs a conference room.
Welcome to our fifth floor. This is, this is our chief's office. First time it's moved in almost 43 years. So we sit across the street for a long, long time. First time we had our own independent building, and just really tickled to have such a really great space and somewhere welcoming and inviting for the community. That's kind of our whole plan. So you'll take them down and show them. All the deputy chiefs are here together. And then, of course, we have conference rooms all around, so we have the opportunity to bring people in and talk. So okay. Hope you guys enjoy the tour.
Okay. At Greensboro Guilford Crime Stoppers, we pay citizens who report crime to us, and if the tip leads to the arrest of someone, whether they're wanted or dealing drugs, whatever the crime is, then we pay them a cash reward, and it is all anonymous, 100% anonymous.